When it comes to buying a server rack battery, 99% of the time, they're all the exact same shit, for the most part. Some companies put some extra time and effort into making their products stand out, and some companies do the bare minimum, cut some corners just to try to make a quick buck, like Tiny Baby with his OnlyFans. And when it comes to spending money on a server rack battery, most of the time they're within a couple hundred bucks of each other, whether you're looking at the nice one or the one that cut some corners. So is a budget server rack battery really worth it, or should you just grow a set and buy a name brand one? That's what we're trying to find out today. So Vatra, we're gonna call it the VBAT, reached out to us multiple times to review this server rack battery, and we were super hesitant because some of the only other reviews out there on this thing are in German, and the website has tons of grammar errors, and it looks like it was just put together really, really quickly. It's another one of those things where it's like someone's just trying to get it done, and it makes us nervous as a consumer. I don't know that I would buy anything from that site, but that doesn't mean that they don't make a decent product. At the end of the day, you guys have seen a video on this thing, so it made the cut. A lot of stuff we mess with here at the lab doesn't even get to the filming process. But before we get any further into this video, I doubt you guys have any fucking idea what this thing is, so let's hit you with a super quick 2-minute teardown to get you familiar with the VBAT. First up, this thing passes the Tiny Baby lift test barely. It weighs just over 100 pounds and they're extremely awkward to pick up by yourself. And according to their website, it is irrelevantly 70% lighter than lead acid. This is a 51.2 volt battery at 100 amp hours, so it's a 48 volt battery, with a 5,120 watt hour battery bank inside. It is a lithium iron phosphate battery and it's rated for 5,000 cycles at 100% depth of discharge. Basically just meaning if you use it from 100% to zero, you could do that 5,000 times before you need to buy a new one. In terms of the BMS, this thing is rated to stand up against most of the standard things, overcurrent, the low and high temperature cutoff, and so on. We'll get to that later. And when it comes to build quality, I actually really, really like this battery. The whole thing is metal everywhere. It feels solid. It looks really good too, I'm not gonna lie. Like, it's an aesthetically pleasing battery. It's got a nice little screen on the front. It is a touch screen, which is cool. There is no buttons. You can just zoom around strictly by touching it, but it's very fundamental. You have your breaker and your terminals on the front. That is it. It's very primitive. And this battery does work with an app. However, the app is the worst. It's the same app that some of these other cheap companies use. It is, the logo is an elephant and it's called Zeng Chao or something. It lets you see everything, but the app for this battery specifically doesn't let you access like the portion where you can change things. So to me, it's pointless because this battery has a screen and I don't love that. This battery right now is $1,299 and we've seen it for as low as $1,023 on VBAT's website. When it comes to buying a server rack battery though, there are some very important boxes that you need to check. And the first one is, does that server rack battery work with your inverter? In this case, you gotta hope so. There's no communication ports on this battery at all. There's no dip switches at all. There's nothing other than what you see right here, which is a screen, two terminals, and a breaker. If you need this to communicate with your system, it won't. It'll work as a battery for an inverter that can read just a battery, but there's gonna be a lack of communication right off the jump. So that's definitely something to know. The next important thing is gonna be, does this battery protect itself like it says it does? So something that we like to do is run batteries through a surge test, often labeled as overdraw protection, whatever. This battery is rated to run 100 amps continuously. So if you had this hooked up to your system and you accidentally drew over 100 amps, so you put a 6,000 watt load on this battery, it should surge for a brief amount of time and then it should cut that power off, give itself a minute, reset, and give you another chance to figure your loads out. This battery, when you hit it with a surge test, did do what it advertised, and some. This thing stayed off for almost 2 whole hours, which is not ideal at all, because if you were to, say, be heating your cabin with a set of these batteries and you accidentally overdraw it, it cuts off, and that was your only source of heat, you have to wait so long for this thing to come back, you're gonna be freezing. Super bad. We even emailed Vatra in the time because we're like, yo, the battery, did we kill the battery from doing one surge test? And they emailed us back and was like, you're not supposed to surge the battery, which could be true, but also that's why there's a BMS. Look, I don't know. It protected itself. Good job. It came on 2 hours later. Bad job. Every other battery is like 30 seconds. That's all I'm saying. And the next thing that you want these batteries to do with that same BMS is to protect itself from cold weather. So once this thing finally sprung back to life, we threw it in the deep freezer for 24 hours. And in the morning, I tried to run a load off off of it, which it did not let me do, which is good news. And I tried to charge it, which it also did not let me do, which was good news. So when you do get this battery a little bit too cold, the freezer was minus 25 degrees Celsius. I don't know what that is in Fahrenheit. It's rated to not charge below 32 degrees Fahrenheit and not discharge below 4 degrees Fahrenheit. The screen was showing that this battery was below both of those points, and the battery did exactly what it was supposed to. However, it took forever to come back afterwards. Why you do this? We also like to run this through a little test where we see if the breaker ever goes or if it's strictly BMS. We didn't want to play that game with this battery because we didn't have a week to try it over and over and over, so we don't know. And the last thing that you want a battery to do is last as long as it's advertised. So we ran an efficiency test on this thing and it did go ahead and perform exactly as advertised. It was basically 100% efficient. We plugged in a 97 amp load, so it should have ran just over 1 hour, and it actually ran just over 1 hour, which is perfect. If the battery is not 100% efficient, I don't know, don't send that shit back. When we take a look inside of this battery though, I find it interesting. There's a lot of air in here. When you take apart like an EG4 LL battery, for example, or some of these other more popular batteries, it seems like there's a lot more going on in there. This battery seems to have a lot of free space, which I don't entirely understand. It's got some sort of DIY BMS that's very minimal. That's probably why it was working meh. You can see there's two temperature sensors, one in a big dead space right in the front or the top or whatever of this battery, and the other one is just down on the cells. Again, something like an EG4 battery has like 6 temperature sensors spread out throughout the whole thing so it can keep a better track of what's going on. This battery also has no fire arresters in there. I know lithium shouldn't be a fire hazard, but it's still cool to know, again, if you get like an LL battery or a lot of other batteries, there's some fire arresters in here just in case shit happens. This battery doesn't have that. Right away, all the battery cells are in behind this little plastic sheeting. If you go ahead and take off the supports that hold that in, you can see everything else in here. The connections and everything going on in here are not bad. There's nothing majorly standout wrong with this battery. It's just very primitive. It's clean, it works-ish, and that's all it needs to do, but it's just a very early stage battery, which comes into play because this battery is basically, I mean, right now it's on sale, but the full price that it's at is usually within $100 of a Rieksu or a Jackoper or an EG4 or some other name brand batteries. And for $100, I feel like I'd rather have a battery that has like a more functional BMS, that has more sensors and more safety features built into it and a ton of other stuff. Comes with like a name brand, some support. And even if it doesn't have good support from the place it comes from, if you can get it through Shop Solar or Signature Solar, you can get support through them. This, I don't know what's gonna happen if you need support. And at the end of the day, this battery is usually within $100 of that EG4 V2 48 volt battery that we really like. So for the $100, I would no-brainer pick the EG4 battery all day. It's got way more safety features. It's got customer support. It's a trusted name brand. I don't know. I don't know what's gonna happen if you need support with this battery. And honestly, like to save $100, even if you're doing a set of 10, I still don't know that it would be entirely worth it just because it's kind of meh. In my opinion, this is something that you play with if you found it on Marketplace for like $400. That's a sick deal. You can't go wrong if you found a really, really good deal on it. But if you're buying them new or you're trying to make a reliable system, I would just go with something like the EG4 LL battery. But that's just me. Let me know what you guys think, if you have some of these, if you have experience with them, or if you would do the same. And that is all we got for you guys in today's video. I'll catch you guys next time. Thank you so much for watching. Peace out and stay charged.